Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to break down the news and all the craziness and frustrations that have been going on in Dallas. And I want to start off with Luka Dončić. Now, obviously, Luka Dončić, he's the best player on his team. You know, he really does a good job of carrying this load and this offense and everything. But I think that's part of his frustration, the fact that he doesn't have too many reliable players on this roster. And the decisions that the front office has made haven't really panned out, starting with the Steph Curry trade for Josh Richardson. Josh Richardson has had, I would say, a pretty down year for the Dallas Mavericks. They were thinking that he was going to come in and be able to defend other point guards and, you know, combination guards and everything, while also spreading the floor for you, and that's just not been the case. And we also see what the Kristaps Porzingis situation is looking like. Him and Luka Dončić obviously don't see eye to eye. They've kind of bumped heads to a certain degree, and it's been clear that Kristaps Porzingis doesn't really feel like a co-star. And I think some of that has to do with the coaching and Rick Carlisle, him misutilizing Kristaps Porzingis and everything. But I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. And then obviously the rest of, you know, this roster, it doesn't really look like a championship roster. Jalen Brunson's a good player, but I don't really know if he's going to be enough to really compete in the Western Conference with these other combination guards coming off the bench. And then you have Maxi Kleber, who's been derailed with injuries the entire year. And then Tim Hardaway Jr., sometimes he's hit or miss. I mean, in the second half of this year, he had a phenomenal year shooting the basketball. He had a few 30-point performances and everything, and he looked pretty productive. But I think Luka Doncic's main frustration is the fact that the Dallas Mavericks just aren't winning. He's tired of losing in the second round, in the first round, back in back-to-back years and everything, and he ultimately just wants to win.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think that I like what Luka's doing. I like the pressure that he's putting on our front office. And this is a point I wanted to make. I like how these young superstars are challenging the ownership and the GMs and people like that to step up their game when they're trying to find players to put around them. And that's what Luka's doing. I don't necessarily think he's going to leave the Mavs. I think he's going to sign that Supermax, that extension, because it's a lot of money. But I think he's going to put pressure on the front office, like, hey, you guys need to put some value, another co-star that I can gel with, and some more pieces around that's going to help me win, because I'm tired of getting bounced in the first round. So I think that the Mavs got to they got to sit down with Luka and talk about what changes that they're going to do going forward. And speaking of Rick Carlisle, the fact that there was a report that him and Luka did not see eye to eye, and I have two sides on this. I think that with this day and age, and Luka's 22, he's a kid that thinks he's playing really well in the league. He sees it where, like, he wants to do his own thing. There's sometimes where he's not going to listen to the coach, or he wants to do things his own way. And every 22-year-old thinks they got it and they want to do things their own way. But sometimes you got to listen to the coach. But I also think in Rick Carlisle, he's got to understand where Luka's coming from. And those old traditional coaching values is not the same how these kids and how these young stars act today. They're more emotional. When I say emotional, they're more outspoken. They're more getting on Twitter and they're voicing their opinions more. I didn't think that coaching him and Luka seeing eye to eye these past 2 years, that's why I feel like their relationship was very rocky. But I feel like they should bring in a coach that's young and understands Luka and build this young roster up.
Yeah, and I think speaking of the Luka Doncic and Rick Carlisle situation, I see exactly where you're coming from. When, you know, like Rick Carlisle, it didn't seem like he really adjusted to Luka Doncic's play style to a certain degree, or just understanding. I mean, obviously, I talked about the misutilization of Porzingis, but he's also kind of misutilized Luka Doncic to a certain degree. You can't just rely solely on your best player for offense. You have to create sets and put this team in position to win games by utilizing the rest of this roster. I mean, this Dallas Mavericks team, they aren't all that deep, but they do have some valuable pieces around, and I just don't feel like he used them to the best of their ability. And then on top of that, I mean, any coach that put up the production that Rick Carlisle did for these last 13 years in Dallas, they would have been gone. I mean, he had a win percentage of 55% in the regular season, and then in the postseason, it didn't get any better. It dropped 47%.
Yeah.
And then he was 33-38 in the postseason with the Dallas Mavericks. So, I mean, obviously, Rick Carlisle stepping down isn't all that much of a negative. He is a good coach when it comes, you know, just making adjustments and being very tactical and having a great basketball IQ, but he just was not the guy to really get the job done in Dallas despite that 2011 NBA championship. But there are a few coaches that I feel like could benefit by getting hired for this job, and starting off with Jason Kidd. I mean, obviously he's a former player. He was a part of that 2011 NBA championship team that won in Dallas, and he's going to be somebody that also has coaching experience. And with that being said, I think he's a very good candidate. And then the next person I will also say, correct me if I'm wrong on this pronunciation, but Darko Radjakovic. He is somebody that is from Serbia and is very familiar with European style type of basketball, and that's Luka Doncic's bread and butter. And then on top of that, he can also help with developing players because he was a former scout and he's helped certain NBA players like Dennis Schroeder and Anthony Melton really develop their game ultimately in the NBA. And then the third coach I would believe would be a very good fit for this team is Chauncey Billups. He's a great African-American basketball player.
Yes, sir.
He's got championship acumen. He won a championship against the Los Angeles Lakers, defeating that Kobe and Shaq duo. And then on top of that, he's just a very respectable guy. And I feel like Luka Doncic and him could really build a great relationship, and that would trickle down to the rest of this team. But my last two guys would be Mike D'Antoni and Jamal Mosley. Mike D'Antoni, he's more so the safer pick, and that's only because, you know, he's got the most experience on this list coaching out of everybody else. The only downfall is we know he's an offensive-minded coach that doesn't really do a good job of, you know, putting in a good defensive strategy and everything.
Yeah.
But when it comes to Jamal Mosley, he's somebody that has Luka Doncic's approval. He was able to, you know, coach the Mavs for one game against the New York Knicks earlier this year when Rick Carlisle was out with safety and health protocols. And ultimately, he coached them to a win, and Luka Doncic praised him about this. They have a really good relationship. Sometimes in the middle of timeouts, you see Luka Doncic going over to Mosley and, you know, talking to him about what he sees throughout the games and everything. So those are just a list of coaches that I feel like would be a good fit in Dallas.
Yeah, I love those picks, especially two of them. Jason Kidd, I feel like he can literally speak Luka Doncic's language. I feel like they have a good relationship. I remember at the All-Star break, they talked a little bit there, and I feel like him and Luka would just bounce off ideas. They would put guys around Luka, and Jason Kidd would definitely just build up that young roster. And then as far as Chauncey Billups, you know what I think about African-American coaches? I think there should be more in the league, because right now we're seeing four good ones right now who are potentially going to take their teams to the Eastern and Western Conference Finals. So the success that I'm seeing out of these African-American coaches and what they're bringing into these cultures, I feel like Chauncey Billups can be that guy. He has championship experience and will definitely help this young roster and definitely help Luka become more of a leader, more of a vocal leader, and stop getting so many technicals and overreacting to calls and being so emotional on the court. So I feel like he'll come in and be a great coach for the Mavericks.
Yeah, and then obviously, you know, once they put in a good coach, the last thing that they have to do is put in a GM. And obviously, you know, Donnie Nelson, he had a great 24 years in Dallas. You know, he's been a member of this organization since 1998. He was responsible for, you know, building that championship roster that won in 2011. And he was also the person that drafted Luka Doncic. And I think that also has a little bit to do with Luka's frustration. Donnie Nelson and him, they had a great relationship. And when he stepped down, Luka obviously wasn't happy about that. But this front office, they have to do a better job of, you know, just being able to communicate with each other within, you know, from a business standpoint. Because from what I've heard, when Rick Carlisle hired a well-known sports gambler by the name of Hera Lobis Vulgaris, this is a guy that he put in position to be the director of quantitative research and development, aka it's basically a shadow GM. So he basically had a little bit to do with, you know, the decisions made in the front office and everything. And, you know, typically when you have a shadow GM and your primary GM, they sometimes tend to clash, whether it's because, you know, they disagree on a potential starting lineup, the utilization of a player, or, you know, just wanting to draft one player instead of another player.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to get into. Speaking of the draft, they didn't see eye to eye when it came to this past draft with Josh Green and Sadiq Bey. Half of the organization wanted Sadiq Bey, and we know that Sadiq Sadiq Bey made an all-rookie first team or second team. And Josh Green was in the G League for most of the year and didn't get a lot of playing time, didn't get a lot of opportunities on the court. So I feel like that tension just from the – they need to fix that. So I think the GM is important. You have to have a good relationship with the head coach. Got to have a good relationship with your star. So everybody's on the same page, because – now from the outside, now it looks like they drafted bad, but they just didn't give Josh Green those chances. And Sadiq Bey went to a great situation where he got a lot of playing time and got the flurries, but Josh Green didn't get those same opportunities. So they need to figure that GM spot out for sure.
Yeah, and it doesn't really look like Vulgaris is going to be within working this with this organization for much longer, because they just signed Dirk Nowitzki to become a special advisor. So that means he's going to have a say-so in finding a new GM. And ultimately, my guy is going to be Masai Ujiri. Yeah. Dallas doesn't have any specific targets. They actually have Mike Ford making a list of candidates and everything. But yeah, I mean, I think Ujiri, he brings a winning culture to this franchise. He's going to have a lot of fresh new ideas and creative ideas to really help them get back to the promised land. And he's going to help them in their biggest area where they lack, and that's landing free agents, potential free agents and everything. We know this year Kawhi Leonard, Lowry, and DeMar DeRozan are going to be free agents this summer, and Masai Ujiri has connections with all three of those guys. So I think he can be somebody that can really help this organization get back to the promised land. Like I said, I think Luka Doncic will respect him, especially given the fact that he's already won a championship and he's done a good job of, you know, just building that Toronto Raptors roster throughout these last couple of years and everything.
Yeah, I totally agree. And he's very aggressive. I mean, you need a GM who's aggressive and humble. So I think that him being able to go out in free agency and test the market and play, manipulate the market, and also in making valuable trades and getting young guys and young assets and looking over for international players. He just does it all. I feel like he would be a perfect fit in Dallas. Resurrect that that organization well for Luka, so they can go further in the playoffs and find more success for that organization.
Yep, 100%, and I totally agree. Well, guys, I think that's all that we have for you guys today. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and turn on post notification if you're watching on YouTube. And if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But, you know, besides that, it's your boy, Nicey Chunga Benny, and I'm here with my co-host, Greg King, and we out.
We out.